My name's Jayesh, if we haven't met, and I'm going to be reading the Bible right now. So if you've got a Bible handy, or one of the church Bibles as you walked in, we're looking at Jonah chapter 4, and it's on page 926 in the church Bibles. All right, Jonah chapter 4. Jonah chapter 4. So what's just happened is God has relented from destroying the Ninevites, as we saw last week in chapter 3. But to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, "Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you were a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it's better for me to die than to live." But the Lord replied, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Jonah had gone out and sat down at a place east of the city. There he made himself a shelter, sat in its shade, and waited to see what would happen to the city. Then the Lord God provided a leafy plant and made it grow up over Jonah to give shade for his head and to ease his discomfort. And Jonah was very happy about the plant. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm, which chewed the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind, and the sun blazed on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. He wanted to die, and said, "It would be better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" "It is," he said, "and I'm so angry I wish I were dead." But the Lord said, "You've been concerned about this plant, though you did not tend it or make it grow. It sprang up overnight and died overnight. And should I not have concern for the great city of Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" We're going to be having a look at that passage this morning, but before we do that, let's just ask God to help us as we look at his word. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the book of Jonah, and thank you for the lesson that it teaches to us. I pray that as we have another look at it this morning, that you would open our eyes and our hearts to be changed by your word. Please help me as I preach, help me to be clear, and I pray that you'd be moving in all of us by your Holy Spirit and helping us to be more and more like you and to be driven to Jesus. We pray this for your glory's sake. Amen. How do you feel when someone who deserves to be punished seems to get off scot-free? It generally makes most people feel angry. I don't know if you saw Oscar Pretorius in the news this week. He's the former Paralympian who's been convicted of murdering his girlfriend back in 2013. The prosecutors were pushing for a 15-year sentence, but he's just been sentenced to 6 years prison, and he'll be eligible for parole next year. And what was the public reaction? Anger. Same thing with Jared Baden Clay. He's the real estate agent who killed his wife in 2012. Last year, his sentence was downgraded from murder to manslaughter. And what was the public response? 73,000 angry people signed a petition for an appeal. Thousands marched in King George Square. Anger. You get angry, don't you, when people get off lightly? You shake your fist at the justice system and you cry, "No mercy." I know I do sometimes. And sure, sometimes that's justified. Sometimes there's been a genuine miscarriage of justice in the courts, and we're right to get upset about that. But sometimes we get angry simply because we don't want people who have done the wrong thing to be shown mercy. But it's interesting, isn't it? Because when we find ourselves on the wrong side of the law, whether it be something minor like a speeding fine or a parking ticket or something more serious, we've got a completely different attitude, don't we? You're not crying, no mercy, or make me pay. You're begging for mercy too. And going through an experience like that should make you more merciful to others. Now, according to that logic, Christians, of all people, should be the most merciful people around. Because if you're a Christian here today, then you believe that you've been shown incredible mercy by God. And that should make you incredibly merciful to others. But unfortunately, that's not often the case. I know the media likes to beef this stuff up a bit, but my observation is that Christians often come across as angry and judgmental rather than merciful. Christians often seem to be looking down their noses at others rather than empathizing and having compassion. Today, we're looking at the story of someone who gets angry, not at the justice system, but at God. His name's Jonah, and he gets angry at God because God shows mercy and kindness to people that Jonah believes should be punished. Now, if you've just joined us today, we've been in this three-part series on the Old Testament book of Jonah. This is our third and final episode. And if you've been here the last couple of Sundays, you might remember that we've seen that Jonah isn't just a cute little story about a guy who gets swallowed by a fish and lives to tell the tale. The book of Jonah is actually a portrait of a pathetic prophet who doesn't fear God, who doesn't repent, and as we'll see this week, who gets angry at God's mercy. Part one, we saw Jonah's lack of fear of God compared to the sailors. God tells Jonah to preach in Nineveh, a huge city in Assyria, the empire that wiped out Jonah's hometown, and Jonah fearlessly disobeys God. He jumps on a ship headed the other way. And then, when God sends a great storm, the pagan sailors get the message. And fearing God, they chuck Jonah overboard and the storm stops. Part two, last week, we saw Jonah's lack of repentance compared to the Ninevites, the wicked enemies of Israel. Jonah prays to God from the belly of the fish, but there's no real remorse, and he gets vomited out on the beach. He finally goes to Nineveh, but he's half-hearted about it. He dips his toe in Nineveh. He just walks a third of the way through the city. He preaches a lousy one-sentence sermon, and yet, surprise, surprise, the Ninevites repent. Now, this week we're in chapter 4, and we will see the starkest comparison in the book. Jonah's lack of mercy compared to God's mercy. This is the part of the book where we learn why Jonah was running away from God in the first place. And the author of Jonah has been saving this bit for the very end. This is the twist at the end of the tale. Have a look at how Jonah responds to God's mercy on the Ninevites in the first verse of the chapter, Jonah chapter 4, verse 1. But to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. It literally says, and he burned. He's hot with anger. Now, why is he angry? Verse 2, he prayed to the Lord, isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you're a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now that's nothing new. That's what God said to Moses right back at the start of the Bible. I'm slow to anger, abounding in love. So this is Jonah quoting God's own words from Exodus 34, throwing them back in God's face. I knew you wouldn't destroy the Ninevites. I knew it. I knew it from the start because you're so flippant, gracious, and merciful. How crazy is that? He accuses God of being merciful of all things. He seems to have forgotten that God's merciful character is what saved him from drowning in the raging sea. In fact, Jonah's forgotten that God's merciful character is what saved his own people, the Israelites, from slavery in Egypt in the first place. You see, Jonah's got no problem with mercy being shown to him and his people as long as it isn't shown to anyone else. And he's ridiculously angry when it is. Verse 3. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it's better for me to die than to live. And now everything becomes horribly clear. As you look back on the rest of the book, through the lens of chapter 4, you can understand now why Jonah wasn't afraid of drowning in chapter 1 and why he wasn't truly repentant even after God saves him. He hates the Ninevites and he'd rather die than to see them find mercy. He didn't want to preach to them, not because he was afraid of them, but because he knew that if he told them how to be saved, God might not destroy them. And how does God respond? Well, he asks Jonah a pretty simple question. Are you right to be angry? But there's no response from Jonah. Silence. It seems as though Jonah's thrown a little tanty. I'm not talking to God until he destroys this stupid city. Have a look at verse 5. I'm going to go up this little hill, set up my little shelter with this nice view of the city. I'm going to sit here until I see some fireworks. Now, that's a bit odd when you think about it, because the Ninevites have all repented. They've all done what they were supposed to do. You couldn't have wished for a better outcome. But it's almost as though Jonah's anticipating that God's going to change his mind. It's as though he thinks to himself, I've given God my ultimatum, kill me or kill the Ninevites, and surely he'll destroy them and not me, one of his precious prophets. But God doesn't destroy the Ninevites. Instead, he gives Jonah the God that he wants. You wanted an unmerciful God? All right, you got it. Verse 6, God makes a leafy, shady plant grow over Jonah. And Jonah's over the moon about it. But then, the very next day, verse 7, God sends a worm to eat the plant and to kill it. And then, verse 8, he sends a scorching hot wind. And then at noon, the sun is blazing on Jonah's head. Do you see what's happening? Jonah's burning hot with anger, and he wants God to burn the Ninevites, but God burns Jonah instead. But notice that in all of this, God doesn't kill Jonah. Jonah keeps on asking for death and wishing he was dead, verses 8 and 9, but God never goes, okay, smite. No, God keeps showing Jonah mercy. When Jonah doesn't respond to God's question in verse 4, God tries asking it again in verse 9. He keeps pursuing Jonah, even when Jonah ignores him. He sends Jonah the plant and then he kills it, not because he's trying to be mean and he's just trying to mess with him. He's trying to get Jonah's attention. He's patiently trying to teach Jonah something. Now, God sometimes does this in our lives too. Sometimes he gives us good things and then he takes them away, not because he's trying to be mean, but because he's trying to get our attention. And he's trying to teach us something. And what is he trying to teach Jonah? He's trying to teach him that mercy is his business, and he can dish it out how he likes. Verses 10 to 11. The plant represents Nineveh. God's saying to Jonah, you cared about this plant even though you didn't raise it or nurture it, and you were gutted when it was destroyed. So how much more do you think I care about this city of people, which I did nurture and care for, which is worth more than your plant? If you had mercy and compassion for the stupid little plant, shouldn't I have mercy on the people and the animals of Nineveh? And then the narrative just ends. Full stop. There's no happy ending to the story of Jonah. Jonah gets angry at God's mercy to the Ninevites, and we're not told if he ever gets over it. Now, why does the author of Jonah just end the book like that? Why doesn't he tell us what happens next? Well, he ends the book like that because he wants God's final rhetorical question here to be the main point of the book. Shouldn't I be concerned about Nineveh? Shouldn't I have pity or compassion on that great city? It's not just a question addressed to Jonah, it's addressed to the reader as well. And it might not seem like it to you, but this was a mind-blowing, offensive question to the original readers, the Israelites. You see, the Israelites were God's people. They were the descendants of Abraham, and God had made a special promise to be their God, and they would be his people. But you see, the whole point of the nation of Israel wasn't to be exclusive and to keep God from everyone else. No, the point of Israel was to bring God to the nations. Israel was the nation whose job it was to make their merciful God known to all the other nations. God was always planning to step into humanity, into one nation and race, not for them alone, but so that he could be God and king over all races and nations. But Jonah hadn't understood that. And so God's mercy to a nation other than Israel, especially an enemy of Israel like the Ninevites or the Assyrians, it didn't make any sense. And it didn't make any sense to the rest of Israel either. And about 700 years later, when God finally did enter humanity, as an Israelite called Jesus, God's unconditional mercy still didn't make any sense to them. In fact, Jesus himself told a story to make the same point. A story of two sons. One son asks his father for his inheritance, and he goes and wastes it all on wild parties and women. And then he comes back to his father begging for mercy. And his father forgives him and throws a welcome home party. But the older brother in the story, the brother who's been at his father's side the whole time, he's angry. He's angry because he doesn't want his younger brother to be shown mercy. He wants him to be punished. And Jesus' point in telling that parable was to teach his listeners, to teach the Israelites, hey, God isn't just merciful to you, he's merciful to everyone. He's merciful to Israelites and non-Israelites. He's merciful to the religious and the irreligious, to the people who try hard to keep all the rules, and to the people who have wandered way off track. He's merciful to all kinds of people who humbly turn back to him, no matter who they are or what they've done. So don't be angry when God shows mercy to others. Join the party. Celebrate the Father's mercy and compassion. Look, if you're someone here today who hasn't seen that compassion in action, and you haven't seen Christians as people who celebrate God's compassion for anyone who turns back to him, I just want to say sorry. Because as I said at the beginning, Christians ought to be people who are the most compassionate and merciful to others. Why? Because Christians are people who have had all their wrongdoings mercifully forgiven. And it's not as though this wrongdoing goes unpunished. It's not as though God just turns a blind eye to it. No, because Jesus himself went to the cross to take the punishment of every wrong on himself, to balance the books completely and perfectly at the cost of his own life. That's what mercy costs. But again, if you're a Christian, it's the same costly mercy you've received that God offers to everyone else. Which means if you're someone who calls yourself a Christian and you're not merciful or compassionate, what's the story? Sure, you might not necessarily get angry at God for showing mercy to others, but are there people in your life who you're unmerciful towards? Are there people in your life that you refuse to forgive? Or people that you don't want to show any love or kindness to because you find them annoying or difficult to talk to or just different to yourself? Are we a community who mercifully and lovingly accept each other despite each other's flaws? Or do we just pick and choose the people we want to be around? The people that we like? I know I'm like that. I know that my heart's natural disposition is to be unmerciful, to avoid the people I don't like. And I've got to keep reminding myself, Jayesh, you've been shown incredible mercy by God. How about you think about being a bit more merciful to others? As I've been studying Jonah for the last 3 weeks in preparation for these sermons, I keep discovering more and more that I am more and more like Jonah than I realize. And that's the point of the book. You're not meant to read the book of Jonah and think to yourself, what a pathetic prophet, I'm glad I'm not like him. You're meant to think to yourself, what a pathetic prophet, and I'm exactly like him. And I need to be shown mercy too. Which means that I need to be a whole lot more generous about sharing that mercy with others. Let's pray and ask God for his mercy. Heavenly Father, thank you that you have shown us such amazing grace and mercy in Jesus. We thank you for the lesson of Jonah. We thank you that you were so gracious and merciful to him, and you were so gracious and merciful to the Ninevites. And we pray that you would help us to ponder upon these things and to recognize that you are merciful to all, even people we don't like. I pray that you would help us to show this same mercy to others in our lives. And I pray this for your glory's sake.